Hey, crazies. We saw in the last video that white dwarfs are pretty awesome. They're the leftover core of a low-mass star like our sun, shrunk to the size of a planet or moon. But we can get even smaller than those white dwarfs. White dwarfs, white dwarfs, white dwarfs. The next group of stellar corpses are neutron stars. Let's do this. As you can see from this chart, the original star that makes a neutron star needs to have at least 8 times the mass of our sun. Anything less, and it'll only make a white dwarf. Anything more than 20, and it becomes a black hole. Neutron stars are the sweet spot in between. How come an 8 solar mass star doesn't make an 8 solar mass neutron star? Because the whole star doesn't become a neutron star, just its core. A star's core is where the fusion is happening. But that core is surrounded by several other layers that are just hot. Those outer layers are where you'll find the majority of a star's mass. But those layers get blasted away during the star's death throes. Only the core is left behind to collapse into a stellar corpse. So an 8 solar mass star only makes a 1.4 solar mass corpse. And a 20 solar mass star only makes a 3 solar mass corpse. A neutron star is exactly what it sounds like. A star made of neutrons. You know, those little particles you usually find in an atomic nucleus? Except the whole star is made of neutrons. Well, almost. How is that even possible? Because gravity's a thing. That leftover core is heavy, so it collapses under its own gravity, which speeds up the particles inside. Mostly the electrons. The faster they're going, the more kinetic energy they have. If the core collapses enough, the total energy of the electrons will make up for the mass difference between the protons and neutrons. At that point, the protons will react with the electrons and become neutrons. This inverse beta decay, as it's called, happens through most of the collapsing core. After the star's millions or billions of years of life, this last process is very violent and very fast. In a matter of hours to days, the extreme temperatures release gamma rays that smash larger nuclei like iron into smaller nuclei like helium. The inverse beta decay turns protons into neutrons, releasing a flood of neutrinos into space. That core will continue to collapse until something stops it. Cue the Pauli exclusion principle. That principle doesn't just apply to electrons, it applies to all fermions. Neutrons are also spin 1/2 particles. They're fermions too. But because they're neutral, they can get a lot closer together. They reach densities comparable to atomic nuclei before they stop collapsing. Unlike the white dwarf, which is the size of a planet or moon, a neutron star would be the size of a small city. Is it true that a teaspoon of it would weigh as much as a mountain? Not exactly. Okay, so a teaspoon of neutron star matter, also known as neutronium, would have the mass of a small mountain. But mass and weight are not the same thing. On the surface of a neutron star, it's going to weigh a lot more than a mountain, because a neutron star's gravity is much stronger than Earth's. A trillion times stronger. But what if we scooped it up and brought it to Earth?
It would explode.
The only thing keeping that neutronium stable is the gravity of the neutron star. You won't get that teaspoon very far before most of it decayed back into protons and electrons, releasing unimaginable amounts of radiation very quickly. You're dead. Plus, if you're scooping that matter from the outside of the neutron star, you're probably not getting just neutrons. The electrons on the outside of the collapse weren't moving fast enough to make more neutrons. So that stuff still behaves more like white dwarf matter. This also explains how it's possible for a neutron star to have a magnetic field. Remember, magnetic fields require charge. Neutral things can't make them. Thankfully, neutron stars have some protons and electrons left over on the outer edges. Those particles are the source of a neutron star's very strong magnetic field. But that field doesn't necessarily line up with the star's rotation. At the north and south poles, you'll find outward jets of charged particles. And since those charges are accelerated, they produce light that beams into space. Light that could be anywhere on the spectrum, from radio waves to gamma rays. This creates a kind of lighthouse effect. And if things line up just right, we can receive a regular pulse here on Earth. If that's the case, we call it a pulsar, which is just short for pulsing star. And these things spin fast, fast. So the pulses are more like this, or even faster. This used to be the only way we could discover them. But now with LIGO, we can detect more of them by their gravitational waves. Especially when they hit each other, like this. Oh, what was that for? On top of that, because of gravitational warping, neutron stars would look really weird up close. You could actually see part of its back when looking at the front. These things are weird. So, got any other questions about neutron stars? Ask in the comments. Thanks for liking and sharing this video. Don't forget to subscribe if you'd like to keep up with us. And until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy. Speaking of Patreon, support at any level now gets you exclusive access to video bloopers. In fact, I just uploaded a new one. If you're pledging, you should go check it out. And thanks for watching.